I think most of these people know me, and they know that I know about nothing other than breast cancer, which I apologize for those of you who have heard this story, but was brought home to me many, many years ago when I was trying to diagnose my then 10-year-old son. I was trying to play dermatologist, and he had this rash around his face. And he went to the dermatologist, and the dermatologist said, you know, your father doesn't know what he's talking about. You know, you have perioral dermatitis. He came home and said, you know, I have perioral dermatitis. I said, no, I don't really think you do. He said, Dad, if you had if I had breast cancer on my face, I'd listen to you. Otherwise, I'm sticking with the dermatologist. Yeah. I'm here to talk for just about 5 minutes about breast cancer, and then introduce our next speaker. So the facts are well known to you. There are 250,000 cases of breast cancer in the United States each year. There are still 40,000 deaths from breast cancer in the United States. The numbers worldwide are far more staggering. There are somewhere in the range of 500,000 breast cancer deaths around the world each year. We have made clear progress in breast cancer. We've made progress in understanding the disease and understanding that it's not one disease, but it's a family of diseases. We've made progress in some of the subtypes of breast cancer, in some of those family members. In particular, we have made progress in HER2-positive breast cancer, where drugs like Herceptin and Perjeta and other drugs have made a difference in the quality of people's lives and how long they live. And we've made, very recently, tremendous advances in hormone receptor-positive breast cancer that is sensitive to the influences of female reproductive hormones. Where, unfortunately, we've made less progress is in the area of what's often called triple-negative breast cancer. Triple-negative, we call it by what it isn't. It's not sensitive to hormones. It's not sensitive to the anti-HER2 agents. And although triple-negative breast cancer only accounts for about 10 to 15% of all breast cancer in the United States, it accounts for a disproportionate degree of the mortality. And so it would come as no surprise to any of you that some of the powerful new immuno-oncology drugs that Dr. Glimcher was talking about have been applied to triple-negative breast cancer, and not just because we haven't had other things, but because there was strong scientific rationale. And I'd say where we are is we have maybe some runners on base, no home runs yet. These drugs have been shown to work in a small number of women with triple-negative breast cancer, probably about 15 to 20% of women in the early clinical trials. And what has been even more promising is that when they work, they seem to work for a long time, for many, many months, for years in some women. And there are multiple studies going on at the moment exploring these drugs either alone or in combination with chemotherapy, or in combination with some of the targeted therapies identified through precision medicine, looking at these combinations to see if we can do that much better. For the moment, this is largely part of clinical trials. There are occasionally patients treated outside of clinical trials, but this is really something that needs to be done within a research setting. And we need to understand how to make these drugs work better. And we also, very importantly to the points already made, we need to understand in whom they work and in whom they don't. And that really takes bringing together scientists and clinicians. And I have to say, I don't think there's any place that does that as well as we do. I was at the National Cancer Institute yesterday and was talking about our breast cancer program before putting in an application, and I made that point that there is really this seamless integration of science and clinical medicine. Before introducing Robin Nash, I just want to make a couple of very quick points. I think we have three major challenges in breast cancer. One is to figure out how to develop better treatments, for those women who at the moment are still suffering and ultimately dying from breast cancer. Two, we need to figure out how to reduce treatment in many women who are getting too much treatment so that we can reduce suffering not from the disease but from the treatment. And three, we have to figure out how to deliver all these treatments not only to women around the United States but to women around the world. And I have to say that more than at any other time in my now 28-year career as a breast cancer doctor, I have the sense, and I think people around me have the sense, that at least in terms of the first two problems, figuring out how to develop better drugs, figuring out how to minimize unnecessary toxicity, that the question is no longer can we do this, but it's when we do this, which is why we really want to step on the accelerator hard and speed up the pace of research. I'm really very, very hopeful about where we'll be in 5 years and 10 years, and I don't even want to talk about 20 years because I think we will have solved those questions by then.